Hello students, welcome to the new session of the renal physiology, which is micturition. What is micturation? Micturation is a process of voiding of the bladder after it is fully, that is, once the capacity is filled. It is the process by which the urine is expelled to the urethra, that is called as micturation. Now let's understand the physiological anatomy of the bladder. The bladder as such, it has got the body part. And this conical part, this will be called as the neck of the bladder. This is the body and this is the neck of the bladder. Neck has got the important function. Whenever the bladder is filled up to its capacity, that is 400 ml, and then some urine will go and pass into the neck and it will cause stretching of the neck. And this will generate the micturition reflex and ultimately which is causing the voiding of the filled up bladder. That will be called as micturition, right? The muscle of the bladder is generally called as detrusor muscles. What is the peculiarity of this detrusor muscle? It is a smooth muscle and it is a syncytium. What is this syncytium? It will act as one unit. Why it can act as one unit? Because there are gap junctions between the muscle fibers. So whenever the action potential is generated in one action potential or it is given to the one muscle fiber, it rapidly spread into the all the muscle fiber, and because of that the bladder can act as one unit, all the muscle fibers will contract together. What is the importance of syncytium? Contracting together. Why this is required? It is required to generate the pressure in the bladder. If sufficient pressure is generated, then only the urine can be voided to the urethra. Right? Then you have to understand, one, this structure, the mucosa of this structure is quite different than that from the other mucosa. This is rugose, but this is the smooth mucosa. This section is called as trigone of the bladder. What lies at the angles of the trigone? The ureters will pass and it will open at the angles of the trigone. This ureters, before they open into the bladder, they pass obliquely in the muscles of the bladder for some few centimeters. This oblique passage of this ureters in the muscles of the bladder is important, because whenever that will generate a anatomical wall, we can say, which remains closed. Whenever the muscle is contracting, naturally this urethral openings, they will get closed, and this is important because the urine should not be reflexed back into the ureter. So this will act as a wall, the passage of oblique passage of the ureters. Going to the physiological anatomy again, this part of the urethra, now it will be thickened one, few centimeters, that will be thickened one. This thickened smooth muscle fibers, it will be having a tone of itself, and this will act as a internal urethral sphincter. Then this urethra will pass to the urogenital diaphragm, and once when it is passing through the urogenital diaphragm, it is surrounded by the skeletal muscle fibers. Now this skeletal muscle fibers, which will be supplied by the somatic or the voluntary nerves, they remain in a state of contraction. So this will act as an internal urethral sphincter, whereas this will act as an external urethral sphincter. Remember, internal urethral sphincter is not under the voluntary control. It is just a collection of the smooth muscles which are thickened up. Whereas the external urethral sphincter, which is formed by the skeletal muscle fiber, it is under the control of the voluntary control, and it is supplied by the somatic nerve, that is the pudendal nerve. Innervation of the bladder. Now, look at this slide. As you can see here, mainly the pelvic nerves through sacral plexus, they end up in mainly S2 and S3 segment of the spinal cord, where all the reflexes, that is reflexes, micturition reflexes, is being integrated at the level of the spinal cord itself. This pelvic nerve carries both sensory as well as motor fibers. What is the function of sensory fibers? Sensory, they will carry the sensory impulses, and here the impulses they carry is mainly of the stretch. Whenever the bladder is getting filled up, the detrusor muscles, they will be getting stretched. This stretching in the bladder, that will be ultimately pass through the sensory muscle fibers and through the pelvic nerves, it goes to the S2 and S3 segment of the spinal cord mainly. Right. And from here, the reflex is completed and the motor fibers will start. And this motor fibers, these are mainly the parasympathetic fibers. These are the ones which are going to cause contraction of the detrusor muscle. So what is the function of these parasympathetic motor fibers? To cause contraction of the detrusor muscles, and ultimately the muscles will contract and the bladder will get emptied. Apart from the parasympathetic stimulation, there is some sympathetic stimulation also to the bladder. This sympathetic stimulation has got less role in the micturition reflex as such, but the sympathetic fibers will supply the vessels and they will stimulate the blood vessels of the bladder. The skeletal muscle fiber, as I have told you, this muscle fibers of the external urethral sphincters, they will be supplied by the pudendal nerve, which is under the control of the, this will be supplied by the pudendal nerve, which is under the voluntary control. Now, filling of the bladder and the function of the ureters. As I have told you, as soon as some urine gets collected into the renal pelvis, the renal pelvis has got the smooth muscle. So the renal pelvis will get stretched up, and stretching of this renal pelvis will generate the wave of peristalsis. So this wave of peristalsis will pass through the ureter. And ultimately, because of this peristalsis, the urine will flow, and because of this peristalsis, this lower ureteral wall, we can say, that will get open up and the urine will be emptied into the bladder. This peristalsis of the ureter, these are enhanced by the parasympathetic system, whereas sympathetic stimulation will decrease this peristalsis. If there is a blockage to this ureter, let's say because of the stone, in this case, because of this blockage, the parasympathetic system will try to constrict more strongly to expel the stone, but at the same time, the sympathetic stimulation will try to inhibit this constriction. Now, some of the applied aspects related to this physiological anatomy. There are cases in which there is abnormality in the uretero-vesical wall. What is this uretero-vesical wall? Oblique passage of the ureter in the muscles of the bladder. Because of that, a wall is being formed. In some of the patients, you will see that this oblique passage is very narrow, and because of that, this uretero-vesical wall is not competent enough. So in this case, what will happen? If there is excess of constriction of the bladder, some of the urine can enter in the ureters and it can cause the retrograde pressure. If the pressure is very high enough, it can even cause the pressure that will be generated in the kidney, retrograde pressure. Pain sensation in the ureters, ultimately it will cause a reflex. Suppose, again, if there is a stone here and now strong parasympathetic stimulations are there which are causing strong peristalsis, the aim of them is to cause expulsion of the stone, but your ureter is not able to overcome that obstruction. In that case, a reflex will be generated that will be called as ureteroreflex reflex. That means a reflex from the ureter to the kidney. And in that case, a sympathetic stimulation will be there, which has got the effect to decrease the GFR. You can understand the importance of this. If the GFR is decreased, what will happen? The amount of filtrate form, the urine form, that will be less, and the backward pressure that can be decreased. So that is the importance of the ureteroreflex reflex. Next, we have to understand about the systometrogram, or whenever the bladder is getting filled up, how the reflexes, that is the micturition waves, they are being generated. And if you draw a chart with the pressure and the amount of the bladder that is being filled up, the volume, that will be called as systometrogram. Now this is the systometrogram which I have drawn. On the x-axis you can see that this is the volume of the urine that is collected in the bladder in ml, 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, that is the 400 is the capacity. This is the pressure that is generated. As you can see that the compliance of the bladder, compliance means what? The change in the pressure related to the volume. So initially the compliance is high. That means even if the bladder is getting filled up from 100 to 200, the pressure will not increase much. But afterwards, whenever there is filling from 200, 300, 400, sharp increase in the pressure. And whenever the pressure is being increased, now these are called as micturition waves. What is this micturition? You have micturition reflexes. They will be generated. And as the bladder is getting more and more filled up, this micturition waves will get summit and the pressure in the bladder that will increase further. Ultimately, micturition results because of the summation of this micturition waves. Right. This spontaneous micturition waves, as you can see here, they start to generate after 200 ml of the urine is getting filled up into the bladder. And ultimately, the pressure will again increase up till when there is the bladder gets filled up till the 400 ml. What generates this micturition wave? The reflex arc. What is the reflex arc? The sensory fibers. Whenever there is a stretch of the bladder, the sensory fiber will detect this stretch. They will through the pelvic nerves, sacral plexus, again S2 and S3 segment, they will send the impulses. From there, the parasympathetic motor fibers will start and they will cause constriction of the bladder. Now, this micturition wave, initially they are feeble. But once some urine enters in the neck of the bladder, now this micturition waves and the micturition reflex will become self-regenerative. That means it will become more and more strong enough. And ultimately, if at all the situation is right, and if it will cause the relaxation of the internal urethral sphincters, it will cause relaxation of the external urethral sphincters, and the urine will be voided out, and the micturition reflex that will be completed. Right? As you might be seeing, and this is a common clinical picture, what we can see that an infant passes urine even at any time. Whenever the bladder is filled, micturition reflex that will be generated, it will be complete at the level of the spinal cord, and the voiding will take place, the micturition will take place. But when we teach the infant, whenever he is growing up now, and at a particular age, we start teaching him that no, this is not the right place to void the urine, or this is not the right place to urinate. What we are basically teaching him, or what he is then trying to do, to inhibit the micturition reflex. And from where we get this inhibition? We get this inhibition from the higher centers. So the higher centers, they have got both the capacity to inhibit the basic micturition reflex, which is complete at the spinal cord, or even to facilitate it whenever the place or the time is right. So that's why how the adults, they do it. Right? So what is the function of the higher centers? To keep the basic reflex in partially inhibited state. They can prevent the micturition when it is inconvenient, and they can facilitate the micturition when the situation becomes convenient. At the same time, you might have seen that if the person goes for the voluntary urination, even if the bladder is not completely filled up, the voluntary urination can take place. Now, how the micturition reflex is generated in that case? In that case, the person will cause compression of the abdominal muscles, the pressure in the abdomen that will be increased. Because of that, some urine will go into the neck of the bladder, and once it goes into the neck of the bladder, the micturition reflex that can be generated. So that is the importance how the voluntary urination that can be initiated. Now, related some of the applied aspects related to the micturition, there is a condition that is called as atonic bladder. Atonic means what? Where there is no tone, loss of tone of the bladder. In this case, what will happen? If, let's say, suppose the sensory fibers which detect the stretch in the detrusor, so stretch in the bladder, if they are destroyed, so what will happen? The micturition reflex will not be completed, and the bladder will just act as a bag where there is no reflex at all. So the urine will get filled up. Whatever the amount of urine get filled up, there no contraction, because there is no reflex that is being completed, and because of that, the bladder will get now overflow incontinence. That will be called as overflow incontinence. There will be dribbling of the urine now because of the overflow. But there is no actual micturition reflex as such. In what condition this atonic bladder can happen? This can happen in syphilis. This condition where the sensory fibers, they are being destroyed. This is called as Tabes dorsalis. There is another applied condition that is called as automatic bladder. Now, what do you mean by automatic bladder? This is just like an infant. What the infant, whenever the bladder is full, the micturition reflex will take place, the voiding will take place. The infant will not have any control over, voluntary control over it. Similar things can happen if there is a spinal cord damage above the sacral, that is S2, S3 level. So, inhibition of facilitation from the higher centers, that will not be there on the basic micturition reflex. So in this case, the bladder will behave as an automatic bladder. Whenever the bladder you're getting is filled up, the person will not have any control over that, it will get automatically emptied. This is called as automatic bladder. There are cases in which the person has to be trained, pinching of the skin or just over the thighs or other mechanisms where they can go for the urination periodically to avoid the inconvenience. There is another applied condition related to that, that is called as hyperplastic bladder. Now what will happen in this case? There is a loss of inhibitory signals. Remember, from the higher centers there are facilitatory as well as inhibitory centers. So if there is a loss of inhibitory centers, what will happen? The facilitatory signals will become more dominant and they will always try to facilitate the micturition reflex. So either the bladder will remain in a sustained state of contraction, the capacity of the bladder will decrease. And it will remain in a, so again, the situation will be that the bladder remains in a state of contraction, and whenever the small urine is getting filled up, it is continuously getting emptied, little bit amount of the urine. So this is called as hyperplastic bladder. This happens if there is a loss of inhibitory signals from the higher centers. So here with this, we end with the lecture of micturition.